Welcome to the Born Free podcast, where we'll discuss the challenges facing the world's wildlife and ecosystems. My name's Sarah Locke, and I'll be talking to the passionate people doing their bit to try and secure a future where wildlife and humans can peacefully coexist. So today we're joined by Penny Banham, Born Free Conservation Officer. Welcome, Penny.
Thank you so much for having me.
No worries. So Born Free, the office is based obviously in Sussex, but you work on projects all over the world. Do you want to tell us a little bit just how that works?
Yeah, so we've got our Tier 1 projects, which are projects that we run and manage. And we've got one in India, a couple in Kenya, but our main focus is in Africa. Mm-hmm. And then we have our Tier 2 projects, which we just give more like financial support to. Sometimes we might give a bit of advice or like technical expertise, but really that's just more of a supporting role. And those are a bit more spread out. So we've got a lot in Asia, Africa, and then even one in Argentina.
Okay. So lots of different plates spinning all over there.
Yeah. We're constantly getting reports back in, and I'm constantly having to, you know, switch from thinking about lions to then maybe about tigers and then, you
That's
know.
That's nice. So really diverse, I guess.
Really diverse. Yeah. Really.
And do you ever get to go and, I know that you get to go and visit those projects every now and again. And obviously you've had a busy few weeks. Yep. You've just come back from Kenya, right?
Yeah. So we went to go visit our two Tier 1 projects there, one in Amboseli and one in Meru. And it was really interesting, and it's so great for me because it gives us a lot more context, you know, because it's okay here reading reports and seeing photos, and that gives us quite a lot of information.
Sure.
But actually being out there and seeing it and smelling it, you know, it just totally changes your view. So in Amboseli, I realized that it was a lot more arid than I thought it was, and also the area is vast.
Yeah, so it's at, where are we? So it's at the bottom of Kilimanjaro, isn't it? So it's right on the border.
So
is that
it's in
right?
Southern, yeah, in southern Kenya, you're really close to the border of Tanzania there, and it's
kind of dusty, dry,
super
plains.
Dusty. Yeah, but beautiful. It was just amazing down there. I loved it.
Did you see lots of wildlife?
Yeah. So the rains had just started. So actually a lot of the wildlife had left Amboseli National Park and was actually just, you know, roaming around the ecosystem.
So they leave the park when
when it rains.
And where do they head off? Is that...
I'm not sure where they
Okay, so they really roam.
I think everyone was asking that question as where have they gone?
That is a good question.
But we still saw tons of stuff.
Amazing. So. And so how does that landscape different to Meru then?
So Amboseli is quite open. There's not a huge amount of vegetation, whereas Meru is quite a closed area. So it's very dense bush, which means it's a lot harder to see the animals. But it's interesting. It feels a bit more, I wouldn't say wild up there, but it's just a little bit, you feel like you're a little bit more out there.
Is it close to Amboseli?
No, it's not. So Meru is more like in the middle of Kenya.
Okay.
So there's quite a bit of difference.
But and I'm assuming you're like very bumpy roads to get there.
Well, we flew from Nairobi.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's always great because you come in quite low and you're seeing all the wildlife from the air.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Which is amazing. You fly on those tiny little Cessnas and it's just a little bit terrifying. At some points, you know, you can hear the buzzers going off and you're thinking, what's wrong with this plane?
I kind of like don't want to ask. Yeah. I'm just like, get me down. I'm sure it's fine. Okay, wow. So and what are Born Free's activities in both of those places? Because I know they're quite different, aren't they? Meru is a tier one.
Yes, yeah, so they're both Tier 1 projects, which means we run them. We have a team out there in both areas. So in Amboseli, we're working to reduce conflict. So there's a lot of conflict between the Maasai people who live there and lions, actually all carnivores, who come into what we call their bomas. So it's where they keep their livestock and their houses, and the predators come in and kill their livestock. And that creates a lot of animosity between wildlife and people. And so what we do is we fortify those traditional bomas. So instead of just acacia thorn fencing, which is just a tree that's got these massive spikes that should keep out the predators, we put in chain link fencing. We also use recycled plastic poles to hold up that chain link fencing.
And that's such a great idea.
Yeah, it's really good. And then we also have these smart elements. So we put in solar light units and water harvesting structures and energy saving stoves.
Oh, wow. So have the bomas been effective?
Yeah, so they're 91% effective at preventing the predators from coming in and killing the livestock. So that's really great. And it's a really effective solution. So the more that we can roll out, the better.
Yeah, that's amazing. And I know that obviously the amber cell ecosystem is really quite vast. So that's quite a huge task.
It's a huge, it's a huge task. And, you know, the roads aren't great around mm-hmm. amber cell. So it takes you a while to get there. And, you know,
and I guess those are the kind of things that you don't sort of maybe automatically think of unless you go out there and you see it. Yeah, and you're thinking this is going to take a while.
Yeah, because I've been doing some mapping with GIS, just to explain a little bit. That's using satellite images, and you're just processing those satellite images and putting data on top of those images. And when you see the satellite image, you think, oh, it's relatively close. You know, it might take you a couple of hours. Actually, you get there and you realise, well, there's a massive river there that there's no bridge. You have to go all the way around. It's actually going to take a 10 hours just to get to that area, you know? So being out there is really helpful for putting that all in context.
Mm-hmm. So what about Meru? What are Born Free's activities there? Because that's quite heavily focused on lions as well, right?
So it's another lion project, but that's a lot more research-based. So we're just monitoring the lions. We've put collars on quite a few of the lions, and we're planning to do more, which is great, because when we were out there, we were trying to find the lions, and we realised how difficult it is.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, it must be so easy. You just turn up, you just put on your little GPS, tick, 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 there they are.
It's like a needle in a haystack, truly. And because it's such thick bush up in Meru, you know, they could be really close to you and you wouldn't even see them.
Really?
Yeah.
So did you see many while you were at that?
We only saw two.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. And how many do Born Free have collared?
I think it's about 5 to 6, but I'm not sure. I'd have to double check those.
So it's quite a small population, is that right, in comparison?
Yeah, so it's you know, maybe not even 70 individuals, maybe like 65 to 70 individuals.
Okay.
So yeah, it's a small population, but they are growing.
Yeah, I was going to say have the population.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, but the more, it'd be great if we could collar a few more, because it is so difficult to find them. And, you know, the team is spending hours going out, trying to find them. So we can make their work a lot easier if we collar them.
Okay, so obviously you've just come back from Kenya then, but you've actually hadn't been to Kenya before, had you? But I know that you spent a lot of time in Tanzania just before you joined Born Free, is that right?
Yeah.
What were you up to there?
So I first went out to Tanzania because of my master's research. Mm-hmm. So
what master's did you do and where did you do it, please?
So I did, let me see if I can remember it. It's biodiversity conservation and management mm-hmm. at University of Oxford.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
So I started in 2016, which I now realise is actually quite a long time ago. And I came straight out from my undergrad and I knew I wanted to do a master's, and I thought, let's just get this over and done with as soon as possible. So I went straight into that, and it was a year-long master's, and at the end you do your dissertation. And in my undergrad, I'd actually been working on rhinos, mm-hmm. and I was really interested in that.
And that was heavily GIS-based as well,
wasn't it? Yeah, really heavily GIS-based. But I wanted to branch out, maybe look at a different herbivore. So I thought, okay, elephants. And also, you know, I don't want to do it in South Africa, because I'd worked quite a bit in South Africa. I wanted a new area as well. So I thought, okay, East Africa. So I reached out, I contacted a lot of NGOs, just begging them if they had any data or any project that they wanted me to do. Mm-hmm. And I got in touch with the Southern Tanzania Elephant Program, and they said, yep, come along, do some research.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And how long are you out there for?
So originally I was only out there for 2 months to do my research for my master's thesis. It all went a little bit wrong, as most dissertations do.
Oh no, I do remember you saying, actually. Yeah. So what happened?
It was just delays in research permits, which it all worked out fine in the end. But eventually the NGO I was working for, they said, well, do you just want to come back for the rest of the year and just continue working on elephants? So I had the amazing opportunity to go back out to Tanzania and spend an entire year just researching elephants.
That's amazing. So what were you studying? Was it their behaviour or ecology?
Yeah, so I was looking at their home ranges. I was really trying to follow their movements. So I was really interested mostly in the family groups, so following them as they moved throughout. I should say this is in Ruaha National Park.
I was making a mental note. Come back, let's find out where we're actually talking about here.
So it's down in southern Tanzania. Ruaha National Park is huge. It's over 20,000 square kilometres. Mm-hmm. It's got quite a large elephant population, not as big as it should be because of poaching, but it has a lot of elephants. And so I was trying to follow family groups there and see how they were using their environment. And it was, again, really challenging because, you know, you think elephants are so huge, it'll be easy to find them. It's not so easy all the time. And I had a real knack for finding families that no one had ever noticed before, which wasn't great. Well, it wasn't great for my research because I was trying to find the same ones and see where they were. So I could discover lots of new elephants that no one had ever seen before.
And what did your research find? What kind of things did you...
That's the million-dollar question, because I don't even know yet. This is the thing with research and conservation. It takes so long.
Yeah, of course.
And just analysing that data is really an intense process. And then, you know, now I'm working for Born Free, I have to fit that around.
Oh, sure, yeah. No, sure. Okay. And so you were out there for a year in the end. That was right. And why did you come back? What kind of brought you back?
Well, the research permit was coming to an end. Mm-hmm. And I'd loved Tanzania. But I felt quite isolated at times being out there because often it was just me in my research camp by myself.
Yeah, I was going to say, where were you camping?
So we were, for the first half of my research, we were just camping out in a wildlife management area, which is very close to the park. But there was no running water, no electricity. So it was quite a tough environment. And I loved it. It was great. You know, I'd have a leopard come behind my tent, you know, almost every night. And we'd have elephants coming through the camp. It was great. But it was quite isolating. And I don't think many people talk about that when they talk about field work, because a lot of people go, oh, it's amazing. You've been out.
Yeah, quite glamorous.
These really cool places. And I'm like, yeah, it is amazing. Except when you get home and back to your tent and there's nobody there.
Yeah. No, that's tough. Yeah. You must have some amazing stories, though.
I think so.
Like challenges. I know. I'm hinting. I know that you mentioned one that we were talking about the other. Almost catching anthrax, maybe.
Yeah. So there was an anthrax outbreak in Ruaha National Park in October, November of 2017. Yeah.
And what kind of species does that target?
I mean, well, it breaks out in water predominantly. So what happened is that the hippos were affected first. Mm-hmm. So almost every day we'd find a new hippo carcass, which is really horrible. No one wants to see that. And then obviously other animals up the food chain begin to be affected. And one day we were driving along and we found a dead elephant. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I pulled over. I took some data.
What kind of data are we talking about?
GPS? Just GPS data. You don't get out of the car when you're in the national park. You just take some GPS data. And I was just trying to see how old the elephant was and whether it was male or female. And I rang in the death and I said where it was. And as I drove away, I got a phone call back saying, okay, so how close were you to the elephant? I was like, oh, I don't know, about 20 metres, sure. Possibly. I don't know. I wasn't paying too much attention. I said, okay, but were you upwind or downwind of it?
Specific question.
Yeah,
that.
It was very specific. And I said, does that matter, really? And they're like, yeah, well, we think actually that the elephant died from anthrax, so we're going to need to put you on a course of antibiotics to treat it. And I went, oh,
yeah,
great.
Casual, another day.
Fantastic. Just fantastic. I mean, this is the thing. You think fieldwork's really glamorous, and it's not.
Yeah.
Absolutely not. I mean, it was fine. I didn't have anthrax in the end.
But that's an amazing experience. Maybe not the anthrax, but I mean, an amazing time that you must have had in Tanzania.
Yeah.
That's really...
I mean, every day there was something new, something different.
Yeah, of course.
You know, and sometimes I go back and look at my diaries from then. I just open a page and sometimes I can see that I had a terrible day because it's just one line and it was like, this was just the worst day and it never stopped raining and I didn't see a single elephant. And then I open up another page and it says, oh, I saw wild dogs today. And, you know, I saw a herd of 100+ elephants, you know, down by the river. And so, yeah, every day is totally different.
And that makes it worthwhile, doesn't it, when you have those days?
Yeah.
And hopefully when you look back, you know, those are things that stick out in your memory. Like, you know, I've had similar kind of experience. Those are things that stick out in your memory. It's not the days that you stayed in camp because of the rain, is it?
Yeah, absolutely.
So obviously Tanzania does allow trophy hunting where Kenya does not. Mm-hmm. Did you ever, and obviously Born Free, their position would be that, that trophy hunting can exacerbate poaching in some areas. Did you ever come across either of those issues?
So not so much trophy hunting, I can't speak so much for that, but poaching, definitely. So in Ruaha, there used to be over 30,000 elephants, you know, not more than 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And considering the global population is now, is it 400?
About 400, yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah, big stronghold.
Yeah.
And now it's down possibly, you know, some people have even quoted 8,000, which is the very lowest estimate. It could be up to maybe 15,000, but still, that's a population that's decimated. Yeah. And you can see that even in their behaviour. So when we drove out of the tourist areas where there's lots of cars and the elephants quite habituated, their behaviour just totally changes, you know.
In what way?
Well, so families that I knew were really relaxed, you know, would just sort of stand there as I took data. When I saw them in those areas, they'd mock charge me and they'd be, you know, really tense. You could see them bunching up. Mm. They'd run away as soon as they heard our car. Their behaviour just totally changed.
And because their memory is so long as well, isn't it?
And they know they're in a dangerous area. They know, so
no,
their behaviour
really
just is totally different.
Okay, so thank you for that. And your research sounds so interesting. So on the subject of elephants, let's talk about a few of other Born Free's other elephant projects. And obviously, Amboseli we touched upon, but that's also a stronghold for elephants as well.
Yeah.
And just talking about the behaviour, I mean, I know the elephants in Amboseli have a very different behaviour. You know, they're so relaxed.
Oh my gosh,
honestly, how was that? You can get up so close, can't you, in your vehicle, obviously. Yeah.
They're just... totally different. Just
and why is
totally
that then
different? I mean, so people have been, you know, moving around those elephants for ages, you know, and they've been well studied. So they're really habituated to vehicles. They're really habituated to even the smell of humans. Mm. So it doesn't faze them so much. But those elephants do face challenges. Maybe not quite so much about poaching, but there's a lot of conflict in that area with the elephants.
So is that outside the national park?
So you've got all these conservancies or group ranches around Amboseli, and there's a lot of people living there, and they're living quite close to the national park.
I think it's 27,000 or something, isn't it? It's a huge number.
But they've been living there for a long time. But the thing is, like, conflict is increasing. Exactly what's driving that, you know, I couldn't say that I know. Some people might know. But that is a real issue for those elephants. You know, the big tusker, Tim, that I'm sure most people will be familiar with if they follow elephants. You know, he gets into trouble all the time.
Yeah, spears, isn't it?
Yeah.
Kind of his...
Yeah.
And they always find him, don't they?
He's a big crop raider. And,
is that?
And he also teaches the younger bulls to do the same. So... yeah, it's tough for those elephants there, and they're safe in the national park, relatively safe, you know, compared to other areas. But
and you went to go and visit the Amboseli Elephant Research Project, didn't you?
Yeah,
which is one of Born Free's longest running, longest supported, I should say, projects. How was that?
Oh, it's amazing. Their camp is just beautiful. It's just sitting under Kilimanjaro, and it's just amazing. And, you know, talking to Cynthia Moss, she just has such a wealth of information.
Who started?
Yeah,
she's the director. Is that right?
Yeah. And it was just so amazing to just hear what she had to say. And she knows them so intimately. And, you know, I'm sort of sitting there drinking tea with her, just in awe, you know, wanting all the information she's got in her brain to just come to me.
That's really nice. Okay, great. So obviously those are savannah elephants, but I know that Born Free works to support forest elephants,
mm-hmm.
which are a different species.
Yeah.
And a little more endangered than savannah elephants. Yeah. Is that right? Do you want to...
I mean, so at the moment the IUCN is keeping both forest elephants and savannah elephants as one species.
Okay.
They are recognised as separate species. So we don't actually know, we can't say, oh, the forest elephant is critically endangered or endangered. That hasn't been officially classified.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But if it was recognised as a separate species officially by the IUCN, we think it would be critically endangered. So the situation for forest elephants is really dire.
And how many, like, do you know off the top of your head how many individuals we're talking about?
I mean, the information we have for forest elephants is so poor. It's so poor. But we know that between 2002 and 2011, they reduced by about 62%.
That's a huge number.
It's huge.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. A huge percentage even. So where is Born Free looking? Is that working Ghana and Liberia? Is that right?
Yeah. So we've been supporting Liberia and Ghana since the start of this year. And so in Liberia, they are surveying the entire country.
Wow.
It's a big undertaking.
No mean feat.
Yeah, to get an estimate of the forest elephant population, because at the moment there are no estimates for that country whatsoever. There's been a lot of civil conflict there. Mm-hmm. It's quite a difficult place to work. But it seems, because we've just got our 6-month report back from them, that the surveys are going really well. They've seen a lot of signs of forest elephants. So they're not actually seeing the forest elephants themselves. Say, yeah.
Yeah, do you want to talk us through the actual surveying?
Yeah, so they're talking to people in the communities who obviously know these areas, know the forest really well, and asking them, you know, have you seen any signs of elephants? Because you really don't see forest elephants. They're really elusive. You know, they'll hide away in the forest. You could be quite close to them and you wouldn't even see them. So they're asking the community members who are there all the time, mm-hmm. who probably will come across signs of forest elephants, about the information they know. They're also doing rapid assessment surveys. So going around trying to find dung, trying to find footprints to see, you know, where there's a presence of elephants in the area. And then they're also doing awareness, which isn't so much part of the surveys, but it's an important aspect of conservation nonetheless.
And what does that involve? Sorry.
So awareness raising, they're just going out to the communities, and it's not just school kids, which is normally what a lot of awareness raising is. Yeah, it's just talking to everybody and handing out posters and just raising awareness about what a forest elephant even looks like, because a lot of people haven't even seen them. And we know the response has been great. So people are even putting these posters about forest elephants like on their front door of their house. Yeah, so it's been a really positive, really positive experience from what I heard. So it's a great project. And then we're also supporting a project in Ghana, which again is surveying forest elephants in Bia National Park, just to get an idea of the population estimate. There's been quite a bit of encroachment around that area, and cocoa plantations are also quite a big issue in that area.
So are the elephants, forgive my ignorance, are they talking, are we talking about like within a national park, or are these free roaming?
I mean, that's, another good question.
Okay, sure. Yes. Let's stick it on the list.
We don't really know whether they're just sticking in these protected areas or whether they're moving. It's likely they are moving, but where those corridors are, we don't really know.
Mm-hmm. And what are the kind of things that Born Free is looking for? So, you know, before you go into an area and where Born Free are looking to support a project, you know, is there a population that you would, you know, you would be like, that's significant and we will look to protect, or is it that you're looking for, not looking for conflict, but you know, is the conflict like a big driver for you to look to invest in that?
Just in terms of elephants or
and in particular like the forest elephants that we're talking about here?
We work, obviously we're species focused, but also what's important to us is if there's areas where it's a really important area for biodiversity. So, you know, you've got all these large areas of rainforests around Liberia and Ghana, which are really important, not just for elephants, but for lots of other species. So if we feel that our money is worthwhile, it's not just going to help, you know, one species, it's going to really be useful for a whole swathe of species, then it's likely that we'll invest. But I mean, there's so many factors.
Yeah, of course.
There's so many factors that are going into deciding where funds go.
Yeah,
and
of course.
It's a bit above my head. I don't decide. Yeah. I don't decide where our money goes.
Sure. And do you want to just tell us a little bit about the differences between savannah elephants and forest elephants? Because I feel like maybe not that many people know they're actually, you know, different species.
Yeah, so savannah elephants are larger than forest elephants. Forest elephants also have quite straight tusks. They look, I always think they look quite prehistoric forest elephants.
I know what you mean. Do they have smaller eyes, or am I inventing that?
Their head shape is just strange. I can't really describe. I think you have to go and look at Google. Google images.
Google images.
And there's not that many images, to be honest. And they've also got pinker tusks.
Mm-hmm. So why is that?
I couldn't tell you.
It's something they eat, or
possibly,
I don't know. Okay.
Possibly.
Something else to find out.
But I mean, the biggest difference is that we know tons about the savannah elephant and we know almost nothing about the forest elephant.
So these are both, you know, really important surveys, basically.
Yeah.
And especially being across the whole country, that's, that should come back with some really interesting info.
Absolutely.
Finally, just to wrap up, I mean, there are so many ways to enter conservation, as, you know, with any kind of career. How did you get into it?
I mean, I'll start with saying it's a lot of luck. It's a lot of being in the right place at the right time. Obviously, I did my undergrad and then I went on to do my master's at Oxford. And it was through meeting people, through talking to them, that I got some really good opportunities, like the time I spent in Tanzania.
Yeah.
And from that, I then got this job, which I love. because for this job, what they were really looking for was someone with a bit of experience, a bit of time out, you know, wherever. It doesn't have to be Africa. I just so happened to be in Africa. Just gaining that on the ground experience and understanding, you know, what it really takes to actually run a conservation program.
And that's definitely something that careers like that look for, isn't it? That's definitely something that NGOs and other organizations look for, isn't it? Is experience. That's definitely.
Absolutely.
A key part.
It's a key part. What frustrates me is how much emphasis is put on volunteering. I think we all probably need to do a bit of volunteer. If you want to get into conservation, you probably need to volunteer for a bit, gain some experience. But time and time again, I've seen job adverts where they're expecting 5 years worth of experience, you know, and a master's degree. And by the way, we're not going to pay you anything.
Yeah. For sure. I feel like that's definitely, I mean, that's resonating so much with me, only in that, you know, I'm doing my master's and there are so many people that I know that are applying for jobs now, and it's exactly the same thing. It's like, I have all of these accreditations, but then I still need those 5 years out on the field.
Yeah.
And how do we go about changing that? What do you think, what will be the key driver of change for that, where, you know, that just won't be such an important stipulation? Or at the very least, there'll be support when you do it.
Yeah. Well,
I can't
really suggest how we go about changing it, but I know that if we're serious about tackling climate change or deforestation, we have to invest in young people because they're the future. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's this history of volunteering in conservation, which is totally fine. But I think if we want to make real change and impact, we need to move away from that and really invest in people and train them.
No, absolutely. Thank you so much. And just one last thing. You're obviously young. You have, you know, you've got this really amazing job at the moment. What would be your one piece of advice to someone looking to get into wildlife conservation?
It's networking. And I absolutely hate that piece of advice because I got that.
No, I love that. That's different. I feel like everyone else.
No, I hate it. Cause, I get really nervous talking to people that I don't know. And so that was the worst piece of advice that I could hear. But having now done it, I realise how important it is. So if you're like me and you're really nervous and you get really anxious, I know it's tough. But if you can go out and talk to some people, even just send people an email and say, hey, do you have any work that I could do? You know, that is going to get you a bit more known in the field of conservation. Then, you know, you go to a job and you say, oh, I work for that person. They say, oh, I know so-and-so. And oh,
there's always a link.
Yeah, there's always a link. And that's how you begin, I think.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you very much, Penny. It's been great to have you.
It's been great to be here. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Born Free podcast. If you've enjoyed this episode, please subscribe to our YouTube channel to watch the episodes, follow us on social media, or head to our website, bornfree.org.uk. My name's Sarah Locke, and our producer's Philip Fortuna. See you next time.